most people just can't quite comprehend that this can happen. And also, why would you want to kind of accept it as truth?
Good afternoon and welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Lisa Donnelly. I'm head of European Operations and global head of core operations. And I'm delighted to welcome broadcaster, journalist and author Louise Hulland. Most recently, Louise has become known for her work on modern slavery, and she published a book last year covering the topic entitled Stolen Lives, Human Trafficking and Slavery in Britain Today. Louise, thanks for joining us. One of the things that came as a huge surprise to me in learning more about this is that the majority of the 136,000 people are British. And I think we might be guilty of thinking of this as a far away problem, or mostly people like you just referred to that are brought here, you know, from another country. But clearly there's another dimension to this, and it's happening here to people who've lived here for most or in fact all of their lives in some cases. What kind of experiences do these people have, and what are some of the examples of that?
So one of the reasons that the numbers in the UK have gone up now in the way that we're counting them is because of the criminal gangs around county lines. So if you don't know, county lines is a crime prevalent in all over the UK now, where drug dealers will use, manipulate, scare, persuade, groom young people to carry drugs from A to B. The county lines are the phone numbers, not the actual lines of the county. It's not a geography thing. It's the lines, the phone lines that they use. And their tactics, again, focus on fear, manipulation, coercion. Hey, if you do this for me, you'll be in my gang. We'll look after you. You'll earn this money, or through threats as well. So that's one of the big reasons of why the numbers in the UK or why victims in the UK are rising, because this is a crime that's on the rise. Secondly, we also hear stories of the manipulation and the abuse and the kidnap and the enforced slavery of people who have not necessarily had the best luck in life, people who are living on the streets, people with addiction, substance issues. They're easy pickings for traffickers. And I think one thing's really important probably at this point to say is to get an idea of the mind of the trafficker. This is £120 billion a year crime. It is low, low risk, very high reward for the criminal gangs. So for them, they have no qualms about treating people as poorly as they need to do, whether it is plying someone already vulnerable with their substances that they need to keep them under their control, whether it's luring them with the possibility of a better life and a better job, or whether it's through control and fear.
What is being done at the governmental or charitable level to increase the risk of the perpetrators to do something about this, to address it?
Well, I think it's firstly really important to say that things are being done. I think there's probably a big debate around how much, how quickly and how well. There are some amazing charities working on the ground here in the UK and abroad. And there's some really good joined up thinking happening globally as well. The game changer in Britain was the Modern Slavery Act in 2015. It was the passion project of Theresa May. And as one person in my book told me, there may be a lot of questions around her premiership towards the end in terms of Brexit and how that played out. But this is one thing that she can be really, truly proud of. Politics aside, the Modern Slavery Act, it's been world-changing legislation. I think a lot of people say, well, does it go far enough? And we can debate that for sure. But the Modern Slavery Act of 2015 has been used as guidance globally as well. I believe Australia has also used our legislation as a template for their own. And essentially what it did, it did three things. It brought all the bits of legislation that were already there that the police had to scramble about to use to try and prosecute such cases into one place. So they said, right, this is legislation now specifically about trafficking and slavery, which is obviously really helpful to the police, to prosecutors, etc. It also changed sentencing to make sure that the sentences were tougher for judges. And it brought in something called Section 54, which is really interesting because it brings in the business side of modern slavery. It was saying that basically big businesses had to provide a modern slavery statement, essentially saying what they're doing to identify slavery in their supply chain, what they're doing to identify it, what they're doing to stop it. Now, there are loads of criticisms around how meaty, for example, for want of a better word, that legislation is, how much businesses are being held to those promises that they have to do that. But that was a real game changer in Britain. There are debates going on pre-COVID, of course, as to how that can be improved, because one main criticism was that in the legislation, the bit that was dedicated to helping victims was kind of left blank. It was guidance that said we will fill this in at a later date, and several years on, I think I wrote the book in 2019, that was still a gap. 4 years later, it was still a gap as to what we were doing for victims in this country.
Could you share some of those stories that you've covered?
Yeah, I mean, it was actually Elena's story that changed everything for me, because I'm sure there is a lot of horror in this world, and there is so much of it that I think for most people, we just can't compute it. I think any good, normal, healthy person cannot get their head around the amount of people and this level of suffering that there is on the planet. And sometimes you need to look into the eyes of one person, and all of a sudden that brings the context that you need. Elena was an Albanian student. She just finished her degree. I met a young man called Marco, and they fell in love. And because Elena grew up in a very traditional village in Albania, the idea of any kind of premarital relationship was very much frowned upon. So when Marco wanted to take her to Belgium to meet his family, she was thrown out. Her parents said, you go and you don't come back. And she did that. She went with Marco. And when she got to Belgium, all of a sudden the family were on holiday and she wasn't going to be staying with his parents, and they had to stay in a hotel. And gradually she realized that all was not what it seemed. And one day he took her to see a friend in an anonymous suburban house somewhere in Belgium. She still doesn't know to this day where she was. And Marco left and just deserted her. And that night she had her first client, because that house was a brothel. And she was, I mean, I'm very aware of the time of day, but I think everyone can use their imagination as to the level of horror that she experienced for 10 months in a brothel, where even though she was saying to the men initially that came in, I don't want to be here, this is against my will, it didn't seem to stop anybody. And there was a change in her fate when she found out that she was pregnant. And there was a bit of respite for her because she was quite ill during the pregnancy. And the traffickers basically just let her not work. And one day she, to cut a very long story short, managed to escape. She made her escape. She, I say legged it, but probably not that well, 7 months pregnant by that point, but she managed to make her escape and found a lorry driver, hitchhiked a ride with a lorry driver who she just said, I don't care where you're going, wherever you're going is fine with me, just I don't want to be here. And the place that he took her was London, and that began her journey of recovery and settlement here in the UK, which wasn't, again, without its traumas. And that's where I met her. I interviewed her for another story and we kept in touch. And when it came about that her asylum status and her, I think it's important to point out that normally if we're a victim of a crime, we go to the police and the police give us a reference number, and the police are the people we deal with if we're a victim. But with trafficking and slavery cases, it actually goes through the Home Office. And Elena got the decision from the Home Office that actually, no, we don't believe your account, and we aren't giving you the status as a victim. And therefore, we knew that that would then have a knock-on effect on her immigration status too. So there began a very long and complex journey through the appeals system.
What about the cooperation sort of more broadly, like internationally and cross-border? How does that work, to try and close down some of these routes and lower the crime?
Well, obviously, I can't speak for every case and every police force and every NGO. But from what I've seen when researching the book and from the people that I've been working with, there is obviously a huge appetite. So if a case is discovered in the UK, then of course there'll be cooperation with the police forces in the relevant countries, the NCA, Border Force, all these. There are so many agencies that work in collaboration with other international organisations. Obviously COVID and Brexit, two huge things that could potentially impact that going forward. But certainly the will is there from the amazing charities that I've seen on the ground. A lot of them have a global presence. A lot of them actually work with smaller NGOs. One of the things that I find amazing, and it, again, just to illustrate the point of holistic work, is there is a brilliant organisation called Stop the Traffic, and they work with data. And I'm not that technically minded, so I had to have this explained to me quite simply, but actually once they did it, it was fine. But what they do is because they work with so many people on the ground in countries, they have this firsthand intelligence about what traffickers are doing, what tactics they're using, who they're targeting. They go away, they send that data back to the team in the UK, and they come up with amazing campaigns that are streamlined exactly for the right audience. So rather than it being a generic global response, they're actually taking data from the ground, learning from it, working with it, and then sending back out the right message to target the right people in the right area to say, this is what you, where you are in your village right now, need to be aware of. And I find that quite empowering because it's so forensic and so simple and yet so powerful.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You mentioned the pandemic and COVID. How has that exacerbated the issue? Has it exacerbated the issue? How has it affected it overall, would you say?
Well, like any issue in the world ever, when the world stops, the light is shone away from so many causes and issues that need attention, and trafficking, like all of that, will be one of them. It affects, I think, in three main ways. Firstly, the people that we know about, the people that are in recovery, that are in safe houses, when aside from the fact that their regular routine on which they rely, the therapy, the art therapy, the English lessons, the socialization, all these things that are so small to us but mean the world to them, because it's all these parts of the jigsaw about putting their lives back together, that obviously changed dramatically. And these bits of routine, the bit of agency that they have over their life, that's taken away. It's also potentially very triggering for them, because a lot of the people will be in safe houses or in asylum accommodation with many people all locked up again together. And whilst we know the lockdown was for our interest to keep us safe, that's not to say that the impact of being told you have to stay where you are again, and bearing in mind they don't have nice houses to enjoy, it is one kitchen, a shared space and a bedroom, that's been had a huge negative effect on many survivors, because it's taken them right back to their place of trauma. So that's the main thing. Then we think about the trafficker, the victims of trafficking that we don't know about, who were operating as cleaners in takeaways, in nail bars. When that's shut down, where have they gone? What's been happening to them? That's been a terrifying thing. And that would be amplified globally as well. And the third thing is actually the future now, because we know that traffickers target the vulnerable, whether it's people fleeing a war zone, a natural disaster, environmental refugees, which I think we're probably going to be seeing quite a lot more of in the coming years and decades. COVID has created a crisis. A crisis has created vulnerable people, and traffickers target vulnerable people. So this is only going to make the matter worse. And when you tie that in with the fact that people who maybe aren't as vulnerable, but they'll still be impacted from the economic impacts of COVID, that makes for quite a toxic mix. If you've got a society that's looking for cheaper and quicker, and you've got more people who can be exploited, that mix is potentially very dangerous.
Just again, hovering over the economics of this problem. So you said it generates a huge amount of money, £120 billion for the criminal organisations that are involved. It's getting some focus. Why do you think it doesn't get more focus, or the focus that you think it needs?
I ask myself that quite a lot. And I think a lot of it comes down to the fact that there are so many awful things going on in the world that we can focus on. Secondly, I think I mentioned before, most people just can't quite comprehend that this can happen. And also, why would you want to kind of accept it as truth, because it's such a horrific thing and you almost don't want it to infiltrate your life because it's so horrifying. But I don't think those are good reasons really for us to turn our back on the issue, because it is affecting so many people around the world. And it does affect our life. It, you know, the laptop I'm using to talk to you, the phone that I've got by my side, probably the dress that I'm wearing, it does impact our life. And I think we live in a time now where it is really down. I feel like we're a much more empowered society, and the generation that's coming up after me even more so. And I feel like real change will start to come as the millennials, the Generation Zers, start to have a little bit more of the spending power. Because whilst we, I think, and I speak for myself, I can't speak for everyone, but whilst I feel like maybe previous generations are aware of things but not quite sure what to do, the generation coming up behind us, they are going to hold the feet to the fire of those responsible for making the world a better place. And I have great hope that things will improve as these people come up further in life.
Yeah, I think that's just the best possible note to end on, Louise. Thank you very much for joining us today.